This conference will now be recorded.
So good morning everyone. Are you there? Good
Yes,
morning all of you.
Good morning sir.
Good morning,
thank
sir.
You for your NSS registration. So almost 167 we received registrations from all the students from different years. So out of them 100 will be selected. That will be done by the university, so don't worry about that. So 100 students will be selected for the NSS, right? So today's topic will be on Kitchener Forest Disease, KFD. It is also called as KFD. You can see it is an arthropod borne viral hemorrhagic disease. It is a febrile disease. It is just fever will be there, caused by arbovirus, that is a flavivirus, transmitted to man by the bite of infected ticks. So this is the one which is transmitted through ticks, arthropod vectors. That is, it is a tick is mainly responsible for transmitting the disease. So it is first recognized in 1957. That is especially in Shimoga district, Karnataka. So it is most commonly present in India. Especially you can see this disease in Shimoga district. That is in Karnataka. Monkey disease. So this virus was first isolated from monkeys. That is the dead monkeys. They have done the postmortem and they have seen that presence of the virus in their bodies. So it is also called as, in that place, especially in Shimoga, they call it as monkey disease. In Shimoga, especially in Karnataka, people will call it as the monkey disease. It is popularly known as monkey disease, and it is Kitchener Forest locality. So Kitchener is the area in the Shimoga district, which is having a thick dense forest is there. So in that Kitchener, this disease was found. That's why it is called as KFD, Kitchener Forest Disease. So this virus was isolated at a virus research institute, that is Pune. You can see the doctor doing an autopsy on monkeys. So in that autopsy, they found out this virus in the dead monkeys. So this is the place of reporting first monkey, March 1957 only it has been reported. You can see that almost all parts of the Karnataka are affected, but the maximum number of cases are reported from Shimoga. Maximum number of cases were reported from Shimoga district. So problem statement, you can see original focus Shimoga district, that is almost 800 square kilometers. That district is 800 kilometers. Later on, another four districts were added to that. That is almost 6,000 square kilometers. You can see the largest outbreaks that has happened is 1983 and 84. 2,167 cases were reported and 69 deaths were reported from that. So out of 2,167 cases, 69 deaths happened, whereas in case of 1981, 571 cases were reported. Out of that, 16 deaths were reported. So it is going, infecting a lot of people. That is in 83, 84, 2,167 people were infected, whereas in case of 1981, 571 cases were reported and 16 deaths happened in that among 571 cases. You can see the epidemiological determinant like agent, host, enterovirus vectors, host factors, modes of transmission, and then incubation period. So if you look at the agent, so KFD virus, member of group B toga virus, that is flavivirus, is mainly responsible for causing this disease. There will be prolonged viremia, that means fever will be there for a long number of days, that is almost 10 days or more. So the infected people will definitely suffer with fever for more than 10 days. And it is antigenically related to tick-borne encephalitis, eastern tick-borne encephalitis. So if you see the antigenicity between the KFD as well as KFD and eastern tick-borne encephalitis, they are both are antigenically similar relations are there between KFD as well as eastern tick-borne encephalitis. We can see the natural hosts and reservoirs. So there are different hosts and reservoirs are there. You can see main reservoir, you can see the rat as well as the squirrel. Less important one, the birds are there. You can see the parrot, sparrow, bat, and is there. And amplifying hosts are there, that is monkey. So amplifying hosts are very important. That is, the monkeys are present. So the main vector which carries this virus is 15 species of Haemophysalis. So Haemophysalis species are there, which are mainly which act as the main vectors for this disease. That is cattle. So maintenance of tick population. Ticks feed on blood of the cattle. So these ticks you can see in the screen. Ticks are tick. The tick will feed on the cattle blood, which contains this virus. So especially you can see, you can observe the epidemics of this disease during the dry months, whereas from January to June. Why are the epidemics are more in January to June? Because you can see it is a forest related disease. So people going to the forest before rains, rainy season only, people will walk into the forest. Maybe they may be woodcutters or cattle rearers or the forest workers or the forest employees. Forest employees are the people who are going for some vacation to the forest, like that. So mainly that type of movement will be there in the forest between January to June. So in these periods you can find out the epidemics, especially in the dry months, where the mobility of the population will be there in the forest. During that season only you can find out the epidemics, whereas peak nymphal activity of ticks will be there during that period, and they will transmit the disease. You can see the host factors, age factor, that is mainly 20 to 40 years, because these people will be working in the forest as woodcutters or forest officers or the forest employees, or maybe going to the forest for some other herbal plants, for searching for the herbal plants, or for some research, or for some animals, or for some other activity in the forest. So that's why mainly 20 to 40 years age group are affected by this disease. If you see, look at the sex, gender, males are more prone for this disease, because majority of the male population will be moving into the forest for different types of work. So the mainly they are more prone for this disease. You can see occupation wise, if you see the cultivators visiting forests, so different types of cultivators, they will be visiting the forest, accompanying their cattle or cutting woods. So woodcutters are the people who are doing cultivation in the forest, are the forest employees, are the people who are visiting for vacation or for holidays. So these people, this type of people, they will be getting, and those who are doing trekking also. So this type of population, occupations, they will be mostly affected by this disease. You see this person working in the forest, removing all the plants. If you look at the life cycle, that is from January to May, that is the epidemic season, and June to September, monsoon season, then October to December, nothing will be there, and again January to May, epidemic will start. So this is about January to May. Why we are saying January to May? Because it is a dry season. During that period, people will enter into the forest for different types of activities, and they are more prone for this infection. Whereas June to September is a monsoon season. So during rainy season, nobody will like to enter into the forest. That's why we will not see any epidemics during that periods. If you look at the mode of transmission of this disease, so transmission cycle is from monkey and ticks. So transmission will take place from monkeys as well as from the ticks. Bite of infective ticks, that is especially nymph stages, are more dangerous. So infective ticks, that is nymph stages, are more dangerous, and they are mainly responsible for transmitting the disease to the human beings. So, and one more important point what we observed here is man-to-man transmission is not there. You cannot say that like COVID, it is transmitting from one person to another person. Similar way, in case of KFD, man-to-man transmission is not present. Man-to-man transmission is not present. Only transmission will take with the bite of an infected ticks. And the incubation period is 3 to 8 days. So if you look at the clinical features, what are the clinical features of this KFD? That is sudden onset of fever. So suddenly you will start with fever, headache, severe myalgia, that means total body pains, prostration in some patients, that is exhaustion, you know, in some of the patients. So exhaustive feeling, that means they are saturated, like they feel that they are very weak, they are saturated, like that the feeling will be there. And gastrointestinal disturbances, hemorrhages, especially hemorrhage, you can see from the nose, thumbs, stomach and intestine. So from the different parts of the body, hemorrhage will be present. It may be from the nose, or it may be from the gums, or it may be from the stomach, or from the intestine. So different from different areas, hemorrhages may be present. So acute phase will be for 2 weeks, and maybe biphasic after a febrile period of 7 to 21 days. So there may be a biphasic period, and there may be again fever will be there after 7 to 21 days, characterized by meningoencephalitis, that is brain involvement will be there, return of fever and headache. Fever and headache will be there, neck stiffness, coarse symptom, tremors, abnormal reflexes and mental disturbances. So in the second phase, what happens means it will be that the virus will affect the brain, and it will lead to meningoencephalitis. As a result of that, neck stiffness will be present, and tremors will occur, and abnormal reflexes will be there, and mental disturbances will be there. So these are the symptoms you can find during the meningoencephalitis phase. And case fatality rate is 5 to 10%. 5 to 10%, that means almost for every 100 cases, 5 to 10%, that means 5 to 10 cases there will be death. So case fatality rate is 5 to 10% among the infected people. And if you want to diagnose it, if you want to do the diagnosis of this, you can see high index of suspicion, mostly based on clinical features. So based on the clinical features, you can identify the KFD, and mostly it occurs in the Karnataka, Shimoga district of Karnataka. If at all any case comes from that Shimoga district, so people will definitely think that it is a KFD disease. So fever, headache or body pains, anything. So there in their differential diagnosis, they will definitely keep KFD as one of their provisional diagnosis. Whereas if you see the people coming from Kerala, leptospirosis is very common. So leptospirosis is the most common disease. Suppose a person comes with the disease, so their first suspicion is leptospirosis. Whereas from the Shimoga district of Karnataka, if fever, headache or body pains are present, so their first diagnosis is KFD. Then they will go for differential diagnosis. Likewise, in majority in India, what we do is whenever a patient comes with severe headache and fever and chills and rigors, headache, fever, body pains, like that, so our first diagnosis will be malaria. Our first suspicion will be malaria, because it is most endemic, it is constantly present throughout the year, and it is constantly present throughout India in all the seasons, during all the seasons. That's why our first diagnosis will be malaria. Whereas people from Kerala, so they suspect leptospirosis. Whereas the people from Shimoga district of Karnataka, mainly they confirm, they will go with the first diagnosis as the KFD, and then they will work out for other diseases. So how will you so diagnosis is mainly based on the clinical signs and symptoms, and second one is confirmation, that is by virus isolation in the blood and serological evidence. So how will you control this disease, especially control of ticks? So what I am saying is tick is mainly responsible for transmitting the disease. So in that scenario, what we will do is we will try to control the ticks, and then vaccination and personal protection. These are the control measures which we are going to take. So for controlling the ticks, what are the insecticides we are using? So in forest, aircraft mounted equipment to dispense carbaryl or propoxyl, 2.24 kg per hectare. So what we are doing is to control this tick population, what we are doing is we are spraying the insecticide, that is carbaryl or propoxyl, that is 2.24 kg per hectare we are spraying it, so that efficiently we can control the tick population. As a result of that, we can reduce the incidence of this KFD disease. So in the control of the ticks, we are using carbaryl or propoxyl, that is 2.24 kg per hectare we are spraying, so that we can control the population of the ticks. You can see the hot spots. What they are saying is you have to find out the hot spots in the entire forest, but because it is not possible to spray this throughout the forest, so entire forest we cannot spray this carbaryl. So that's why what they are doing is they are picking up some hot spots in the forest area. That is, suppose if there are any dead monkeys are there, so if they find out dead monkeys at one place surrounding that 50 meters, they are considering it as hot spot. Why we are picking up hotspots? Please remember why we are picking up hotspots. The reason is that we cannot spray or we cannot control the tick population in entire the forest, in entire forest. It is not possible. Practically, it is not feasible or it is not possible. That's why what we are doing is we are trying to identify the hotspots. So what is hotspot? So hotspot means where the place where you find the dead monkeys. Suppose if you find at one particular place, dead monkey is there, then surrounding that 50 meters, you have to consider it as a hotspot and you have to spray that insecticide in that 50 meters area. So that's what they are doing. That's what they are doing in case of hotspots. They are, especially if you see in case of COVID, what they are doing, almost 500 meters, they are making it as a red zone. So in case of corona, what they are doing, they are making a red zones. So surrounding 500 meters, they are restricting the movement of the people. So nobody is allowed to enter into that, and nobody is allowed to enter outside from going out from that red zone also. So they are restricting the movement of the people in case of corona. In case of corona, and daily morning and evening, they are spraying the sanitization. They are doing the sanitization programs, and they are not allowing the people to come out, and the social distancing they are practicing. So everything in that red zone, the activities are mostly restricted. Similarly, in case of KFD, what they have done is they have identified the hotspots. The hotspot is nothing but a place where the dead monkey is found, surrounding that 50 meters, surrounding the dead monkey, they are considering it as hotspot. And in that area, they are spraying this insecticide. At the endemic foci, restriction of cattle movement. So cattle are the human beings are not allowed to enter into that hotspots. So if you're coming back to vaccination, so vaccination population at risk. So the people who are at risk, that is mainly the woodcutters who are entering into the forest, and the cattle rearing people. So they will take the cattle to the into the forest for rearing. So those type of people. And the forest workers are forest department. These are the people, forest department, and those people who are visiting regularly for research purpose to the forest. Or some you can see those people who are working on the animals, or those people who are working on the trees, they will be visiting the forest regularly. So these are the people who are at risk. So they must be given this vaccination. That is, killed KFD vaccine is available in the market, and it can be given to them to protect themselves from this KFD disease. So population at risk must be protected, especially the cultivators in the forest, the people who are residing in the forest, that like tribal population, they will be residing surrounding the forest or inside the forest, and then the woodcutters and the cattle rearers and the researchers who are going to the forest frequently. So these are the high risk population. Though if they are visiting to the forest regularly, they must be given vaccination. So vaccination is killed KFD vaccine, which is available in the market, that must be administered to all this high risk population. And then coming to the personal protection equipment, that is population at risk, adequate clothing must be given. That is full shoes must be given, and then full sleeve clothes must be given, and they have to wear the glove. And then the helmet they have to wear. So all these protective equipment must be given to the people, those who are working in the forest areas, so that they can protect themselves from the tick bite. And you can see the insect repellents are there. We are regularly using mosquito repellents. In our houses, we are using mosquito repellents. Whereas if you are visiting the forest, you must use insect repellents. That is dimethyl phalate is there. So you can use that you can use it as an insect repellent, which is available in the market. You can buy it and you can use it when you are visiting the forest. And then whenever you have to examine their bodies at the end of the day for ticks and remove them. So ticks will be attached to your body, and any part of the body it can get attached. That's why what you have to do at the end of the day when you are leaving the forest, you have to search on your entire body. Suppose where the ticks are lying, maybe on the back, on the shoulders, or on the hand backside, or on the thighs, or on the legs. You have to search for them on the entire body. If at all ticks are present, ticks are attached to your body, you have to remove them. That is also one of the protective measures that which you have to follow whenever you are visiting the forest. And their habit of sitting, lying down on ground should be discouraged. So the problem here is whenever you go to the forest, there will be we don't have the sufficient facilities to sit on the chairs or on the tables or something like that. So what we will do is just simply we will put a cloth on the ground and we will try to sit on the cloth. So that is a bad habit. So if you sit on the sit on the floor or lying down on the ground, definitely the sticks will bite you or will get stick to your body, and they will infect your body with the virus. That's why you have to discourage this type of activity. You should not sit on the ground or lying on the ground. Suppose there is no facility and you have to sit on the ground, so please clean it before sitting. Before sitting on the ground, you try to clean the ground thoroughly. There should not be any tick presence. Tick presence should not be there on that ground. And then you can sit on that or you can lie on that, and it will be safe for you. Suppose if you don't clean the ground and you sit there only, there is a chance that ticks may get attached to your body and they will infect the other body with the virus. So that is about the KFD. And coming to chikungunya fever. So the chikungunya, it is a dengue-like disease caused by Gropius virus. The chikungunya virus and transmitted by Aedes mosquitoes. So in case of KFD, ticks are mainly responsible for transmitting the disease. Whereas in case of chikungunya, so chikungunya is also one of the vector-borne diseases. Here Aedes mosquitoes plays an important role in transmitting the disease. Whereas in case of KFD, Kassimur forest disease, ticks plays an important role in transmitting the virus. Whereas in case of chikungunya, mosquito plays an important role in the transmission of the virus. It is manifested by high fever and severe articular pains in the limbs and spinal column. So what is happening is, in case of chikungunya, if you get infected with the chikungunya virus, you will get high temperatures and severe pain, severe joint pains, limbs and spinal cord pain will be there. So all these areas will be severely affected and you will have severe pain in the joints, limbs and the spinal column. Chikungunya is a local word meaning doubling up, moving to excruciating joint pain. So the meaning of chikungunya is that it is a local word. The meaning of chikungunya is doubling up, that means doubling the pain. So normally whenever you get any injury or you get anything, joint pains will be there. You get any fever, joint pains or body pains will be there. But in case of chikungunya, the pains will be double than the other infections. That's why it is called as doubling up. Chikungunya, the meaning of chikungunya is doubling up. Owing to excruciating joint pains. So severe joint pains will be there. You cannot bear that joint pains. And if you see the clinical features of this chikungunya, the incubation period of chikungunya fever is 4 to 7 days. So incubation period is very less, that is within four to seven days you will get the disease, following which the disease has a sudden onset with fever. So fever will be very high, chills will be there, severe chills will be there, and cephalalgia will be there. That means cephalalgia means severe headache. Throughout the head there will be pain throughout the head. So suppose if you get a migraine headache, one side of the head will be having pain, other side will be normal. Whereas in some cases you can find the throbbing type of headache will be there in case of stress related migraine or stress related headache. Whereas in case of cephalalgia means pain will be present throughout the head. So severe headache will be there and anorexia will be there. Lumbago, that is lumbar column, will be having severe effect, and conjunctivitis. Adenopathy is also common. So you can see the adenopathy in most of the cases. See, in this case only the joints are mainly involved. Joints, especially small joints, are mainly involved in this viral infection, that is chikungunya. 60 to 80% patients have a morbilliform rash. So there is a different type of rash is present in this case, that is called as morbilliform rash, occasionally with purpura on the trunk and limbs. So especially morbilliform rash will be present in the 60 to 80% of patients, and then there will be purpura on the trunk and limbs. Other symptoms are coffee colored vomiting. So coffee colored vomiting will be there, epistaxis, that is bleeding from the nose, and petechia will be present. See, coffee colored vomiting. So coffee colored vomiting will give a lot of differential diagnosis. You can go for GIT inflammation, gastrointestinal tract, diseases. So in those cases also you can find out coffee colored vomitings. But in case of chikungunya also you can find out coffee colored vomitings, epistaxis, that is bleeding from the nose, and petechia will be present throughout the body. So these are the most common signs and symptoms. So the rash which is present will be morbilliform rash, and other symptoms are coffee colored vomitings, epistaxis, and petechia will be present. So a prominent symptom seen especially in adult patients is arthropathy, from which the disease gets its name. So in majority of the cases you will see a prominent symptom, all the patients will complain of arthropathy, that is severe bone pains, joint pains, especially joint pains. You can see in all the cases, in all the chikungunya infected patients, they will have a prominent symptom that is called as arthropathy. Arthropathy means that is inflammation of the joints, pain and inflammation of the joints. So severe pain they will complain, especially among the small joints, this arthropathy will be present. So the arthropathy is manifested by pain, swelling and stiffness, especially of the metacarpopharyngeal, wrist, elbow, shoulder, knee, ankle and metatarsal joint. So it will affect all the joints in the body, and most commonly you can see this involvement among the metacarpophalangeal joints, wrist, elbow, shoulder, knee and ankle, and metatarsal joints. So there will be severe pain, swelling and stiffness will be there. So these are the most important symptoms which you will see seeing, that is pain, swelling will be there, severe swelling will be there, and then the stiffness, severe stiffness will be there, especially of the metacarpophalangeal, wrist, elbow, shoulder, knee, ankle and metatarsal joints. It appears between third and fifth day after the onset of the clinical symptoms, and it can persist for many months and even years. So in majority of the cases what happens is, especially this inflammation of the joints will appear between third and fifth day after onset of the clinical symptoms, and it can be present even for months. In some people within months they will disappear, for some people they may stay for even years also. So throughout the year they have to suffer with this pain, swelling and stiffness of the joints. So no deaths have been attributed to chikungunya fever. So one important point what we observed among this chikungunya infected people is that deaths were not reported. So chances of fatality will be very, 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 very less. So among the chikungunya infected population, deaths will not happen. Only that the people will have the disability and they will survive. They have to bear the pain throughout their lifespan. In some people it will be there for years, and some people it will be there for many months. So how you are going to diagnose this? So the virus can be isolated from the blood of febrile patients by intracerebral inoculation in suckling mice are on vero cells. So you can isolate the virus from the blood of the febrile patient, and then you inoculate that into the suckling mice, automatically virus will grow out and you can find out the virus very easily. So virus can be isolated from the febrile patient, and you can do the serological diagnosis, that is by hemagglutination inhibition test. So this for all the viral infections, hemagglutination inhibition is the best one, and serum neutralization or complement fixation test. So for all the viruses in serological diagnosis, we will do this hemagglutination HI or serum neutralization. So this is also one of the technique where you can find out the virus or complement fixation test. This is also one of the tests by which you can identify the virus serologically. The enzyme linked immunosorbent assay, that is ELISA, is used to detect IgM antibodies. So you can identify the specific antibodies for chikungunya, that is IgM, with the help of ELISA test. And then RT-PCR, reverse transcription, polymerase chain reaction, nested PCR technique has also been shown to be useful in rapidly diagnosing disease. Not only ELISA, you can go for rapid reverse transcriptase polymerase chain reaction. What we are doing for COVID right now, we are doing RT-PCR. Nested PCR technique has also been shown to be useful in rapidly diagnosing the disease. So there are different tests are there for diagnosing it. You can directly isolate the virus and you can go for antibody testing. It may be by ELISA or by reverse transcriptase polymerase chain reaction. Our nested PCR technique has also been shown to be useful in rapidly diagnosing the disease. And coming to the treatment part, there is no specific treatment. So for chikungunya, there is no specific treatment. No specific protocol is there for treating that disease. Just analgesic and antipyretics. So whatever analgesics are available, you can use them. They are sufficient. They will give best results. They will give best result. And then fluid supplementation. So for all the viral infections, fluid supplementation is most important. Aspirin and steroids must be avoided. So the only precaution what you have to take is aspirin and steroids should not be given in chikungunya fever. Aspirin and steroids should not be given in the steroids, because the thing is that these painkillers you have to give for a long time. These painkillers, once you start, you have to give some. Already I told you that this disease will be there for some months, for 2 or 3 months or 4 months in some cases, and in some cases it will be there for years together. So for years together you cannot give aspirin or you cannot give steroids. That's why it is always better to stop aspirin. You don't give aspirin and steroids to the chikungunya patients. Better is go with analgesics and antipyretics, mild analgesics and antipyretics, so that they can continue the treatment for a long time and there should not be any complications from the treatment. So that's why what they say is better to avoid aspirin and steroids for the chikungunya patients. And anyhow, we have to control the vectors. So vector control is similar. We know that Aedes aegypti mosquito is the main target of control activities. So it requires active community involvement. It requires active community involvement to keep water storage containers free of mosquitoes and to eliminate the other breeding place of mosquitoes. As you know that vector control mechanisms, different vector control mechanisms are there. We can follow all the vector control mechanisms. So try to remove the water, stored water for every 7 days, so that the breeding should not take place, right? And then you eliminate the breeding sites, breeding places, clean the breeding sites of the mosquitoes properly, and put the insecticide properly. Then organophosphorus insecticide, Abate is increasingly being used as a larvicide. So you can use the Abate, which is a larvicide. You can use that. It can prevent breeding for up to 3 months when applied on sand granules. Does not harm man and does not affect the taste of water. So Abate is the best one which you can use to prevent the breeding of mosquitoes for 3 months, and it will not harm to the human population also. That's why Abate is most commonly used. Organophosphorus insecticide, Abate is most commonly used for the control of this vector. So vector control is mainly responsible. Vector control is the main strategy which you have to follow for the chikungunya fever. That is Aedes aegypti mosquito you have to control, and is the main target of control activities. It requires active community involvement to keep water storage containers free of mosquitoes and to eliminate the breeding place of mosquitoes. So vector control activities you have to take up. Storage of the water, you should not keep more than 7 days. So you have to replace the water for every 7 days, right? And breeding sites of the mosquitoes must be destroyed. And the organophosphorus compound, that is Abate, which is very good, and it prevents the breeding of the mosquitoes for more than 3 months. So you can use that properly. You can use it properly. and it is not harmful to the human human population. That's why you can use it safely. And what is happening is they found out a new technique that is called as a new technique consisting of aerosol spray of ultra low volume quantities of malathion or simithion, that is 250 ml per hectare, has been found to be effective in interrupting transmission. So what they have done is they are trying to spray aerosol spray of ultra low volume quantities of malathion or simithion, that is 250 ml per hectare. It has been found to be effective in interrupting transmission. So what they are doing is apart from using abate as an insect, as an larvicide, what they have done is to control this vector population, to control this mosquito, what they are doing is they are spraying the aerosol spray with malathion or centhion, that is 250 ml per hectare they are spraying, and has found to be effective in interrupting transmission. So when they spray this, automatically the mosquitoes will be destroyed, mosquitoes will be killed, and the chances of transmission will be reduced. So that's what they are doing. So the new technique is called as ULV, that is ultra low volume quantity spray of malathion or centhion, that is 250 ml per hectare they are spraying, so that they will destroy these vectors. As a result of that, the transmission will be reduced. And the vaccine, so for chikungunya, till now no vaccine has yet been developed that is considered suitable for you. So till trials are going on, clinical trials are going on, and we have to see how far they will become successful. But till now, vaccine is not available for chikungunya, and treatment is also not there. Specific treatment is also not there. Only painkillers and antibiotics. Antibiotics and analgesics are available. With that only you have to treat. Steroids and aspirin must be avoided. Aspirin and steroids are contraindicated. They should not be used on the chikungunya. And the main symptom, the predominant symptom in this scenario, in this infection, in this case, is that it is going to affect the joints, metacarpopharyngeal joints, and severe pain will be there. And the meaning of chikungunya is doubling up. So thank you. So any doubts are there, you can write down, and we will discuss that when you come back here. So please give your attendance. So today we completed KFD. These are very short topics, KFD and chikungunya. So now I am taking the attendance. 1 to 10, please answer your roll call. Number one, please answer your roll call. Number one, two
present, sir.
Three.
Three present, sir.
Four
present, sir.
Five
present, sir.
Six.